Hey folks, so thank you for tuning in. Today we have Roy Hall here from Music Hall. He's the founder of Music Hall, and so we're gonna ask him about his turntables that are very interesting and get some answers out of him. So how are you doing?
I'm fine. I just flew in from New York, Toronto. I think it's Toronto, isn't it?
So you just flew in.
Just flew in this morning.
This is your interview just right off the bat.
I don't get any peace at all. Drag me in. I mean, I haven't even had lunch.
Okay. So yeah. I mean,
that's a hint, by the way.
Okay, we'll go a little bit easy on you then.
That's fine.
Let's go with a little bit introduction on your turntables, your company. When was it first found?
I started Music Hall in 1975, so it's what, 34 years ago I started it. Before that, I had a factory in Manhattan, which was licensed. I really worked for Lin Products, and we were making Lin loudspeakers under license in Manhattan. We did that for 4 years, and we didn't make money at it. So to try and revive the company, we imported a turntable called the Revolver turntable, now long gone. But it was a good turntable. And we closed the company, I decided to go out and sell this turntable. And this was in 1981? The company started in 85. And so I got this turntable and I just started going around the country selling it. And no one told me that CDs had arrived and everyone was throwing out their turntables. And only an idiot would try and sell turntables when turntables were going out of fashion. And it's testament to the point that ignorance is an amazing motivator for business, because if I knew that you couldn't sell turntables in 1985, I would never started Music Hall. So being completely oblivious to what's going on in the marketplace, somehow it's arrived. I sold a few and then I got some other lines. I picked up Revolver was my first line, then I picked up Creek Electronics, which was a really great line, and some speakers, EPOS speakers, which I'm still with Creek, still with EPOS, and various things along the way. And to my great surprise, I'm still in business. Was it 34 years later, not 44, 34 years later.
Well, so, passion goes a long way. So that brings me to the question, why turntables?
Well, I've always liked turntables. I started off in the business working for Lin. We had, as I said, we had this company, Isobaric Corporation. So I, got involved with Lin. They were big in the LP12, and I've always had one. I had turntables before that. I had a Thorns when I first started out. It was a good little turntable. And what happened, Revolver went out of business, and as I say, people weren't buying turntables. But I went to... About 20 years ago, I went to a party in Las Vegas at the show, and I bumped into a guy called Heinz Lichtenegger. Heinz is the owner of Project Turntables. And we had a conversation. Sometimes you meet someone and just hit it off.
Yeah.
Just have a great evening talking to him. So we drank a lot and schmoozed a lot and hit it off. And at the end of it, he said to me, "Would you like me," and I told him what my background was, "would you like me to make a turntable?" I said, "I'd love you to, but you have Sumiko as your distributor." He said, "Yeah, but they're fucking up and I want to mess with them." So when I heard that, I thought, I got to bring in a turntable. So what happened was we brought in a turntable, which was really just a rebadged project. There wasn't much to it. It was a simple turntable. But... we brought it in, and Sumiko went apeshit. They just started, calling and wanting to cancel the account. They didn't want me selling. But what it did was actually, Sumiko would never admit it. Now have different owners. But what it did was Sumiko dropped their prices and started getting their prices of project turntables more in line with the value of the product. So for Heinz's point of view, he sold to me, and he improved his business with Sumiko. So it was very good. But I'll just tell you a little story that happened. After about a year of selling my first turntable, I was asked to go visit the factory. The factory's in the Czech Republic in Eastern Moravia. And Eastern Moravia's somewhere between Poland and Austria. And I went to the factory, and the night before I went to the factory, I had brought a bottle of Macallan 18-year-old, one of my favorite whiskies. Well, it's too expensive now. Used to be cheap. And I gave it to the head of production, and I had a meeting with him, and I said, I'm really pleased with the product, and, I'd come here to design a new turntable to start off. And he was very happy when I gave him this bottle of whiskey, and he said, do you like Schlivovitz? And Schlivovitz is plum brandy, and my experience with Schlivovitz has not been favorable. It's pretty poisonous stuff. And I kind of looked at him. He says, no, this is homemade Schlivovitz. So I thought, great, he's going to give me a bottle of Schlivovitz. Fair trade. Next morning, I go to the factory. We have an 8 o'clock meeting. We go into the factory. I meet the director of the factory. This is an old factory. It was just out of the communist era. And I meet the chief engineer, the second engineer, the third engineer, all these people. And we sit down, and all of a sudden they bring out this flask of Schlivovitz, and everyone gets a shot. So they give me a toast, and I drink it down. And someone else stands up and makes a toast. We drink it down. And we did this 4 or 5 times, and it was 8:30 in the morning, and I am completely drunk. I mean, there's an expression in Glasgow where I come from called legless, you know, which is self-explanatory. Yeah. And I'm legless. And all of a sudden someone says, okay, let's design the new turntable. And I don't know if you can see, but this is the turntable design, the MMF5. This is a 5.3, it's generations old. But we designed that turntable and I have no memory of doing it, but that was... That was the first, what we call, the first use of what we call split plinth technology, which is two platforms, one on top of the other. And that was plagiarized from Revolver. Mm-hmm. Revolver, I'm not a clever designer. What I'm good at is I'm a clever observer, and I know a good thing when I see one. And Revolver used to have two platforms, but they did rubber strips, which did nothing. But I decided, what happens if we put rubber hemispheres or rubber cones between it to give compliance. Mm-hmm. And so I came up with this idea and we designed the 5. And that's been the basis of most of the music, or the better quality music hall, not the entry level, but the better ones, all have two platforms on it. And it's been very successful. I mean, we have a 3 platform in the 7, and in the 9, we have 5 and 7 range of 2 platforms, the 9 has 3 platforms, and the 11 range, which is the top of the line, it has 4 platforms, all with these rubber or sorbethane springs between it. On the better, more expensive ones, we use sorbethane. Sorbethane, I don't know if you're familiar with sorbethane. Sorbethane is a kind of sticky, rubbery substance that has wonderful vibration, qualities of deadening vibrations. Mm-hmm. And we've used it. So whereas a lot of other people either don't use springs, and they just have solid tables, or some people like Lynn or Thorns use internal springs. We use the sorbethane as a suspension, and we found it isolates the turntable, and it also gives a little bit of compliance.
Now that brings me to the question. You said you don't remember designing this turntable.
Well,
after you designed
I didn't design it at the time, but I had the idea to do it.
So after you designed it. When you heard it, what was your impression? Were you happy with the idea?
Fucking A. Yeah. It was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's great. Really, there was all sorts of pleasure going on because, firstly, it sounded good. Mm-hmm. And then, wow, it really sounded good. I mean, what I know about turntable design. It came out much better than I thought. You have to understand also that the factory that makes Project Turntable, they've been making turntables for the past 50, 60 years. So they're maybe longer, actually. They're very experienced. And also the Czech Republic is a country that still has engineering schools and vocational schools. So you've got a highly educated group of engineers available in the Czech Republic. So these guys know what they're doing, you know. So I can come up with a design, but they execute it. And I mean, they execute it, then I get a sample, and then I criticize or change. I mean, it goes back and forth, and sometimes it's a slow process. It's a little bit easier now if I want to design a new one because they have CAD CAM, and they have all these beautiful programs, so you can design a turntable, and then you can flip it upside down in 3D and look at it and look at where the wiring goes. Mm-hmm. So it makes life a lot easier, and you can make. We had a turntable, which we don't make anymore, called the Acura, which was basically a version of the 5. It was really good looking, and I thought it would sell like crazy, but it didn't. You know, it's still a good turntable. But when we were designing, there were some technical issues, and by able to work on the computer, you could actually figure out how to manufacture it and how to place contacts and how to do the wiring. And it made it really easy because we could do it virtually. Mm-hmm. And then once we'd done it virtually, you just put it into production and, you know, you've solved all the issues.